The following program is brought to you by Arlington Community Media, where we tell your story.
This is ACMi News, recognized nationwide as the first place winner of the 2023 Hometown Media Award for News Access.
Arlington formally congratulates its new town manager, James Feeney. What are his plans for the months ahead as we consider zoning changes, a possible override, and much-needed repairs to Town Hall? Our interview with Jim Feeney is next. There are some major changes in store for the town's library system, namely the Fox Library on Mass Ave. We get the latest from director Anna Litten. And a 60s singing group with some mega hits under its belt is coming to the Regent Theatre in October. The Cowsills are invading the town of Arlington with their shining, gleaming, streaming flaxen, waxen hair, shoulder length or longer. ACMi News is next.
From McLennan Park to Spy Pond, from Poets Corner to the Mystic River, we have Arlington covered, giving you stories that count from people who care. Reliable, trustworthy, dependable. This is the nationwide award-winning ACMi News.
Roughly 50 people turned out Thursday, September 14th, right here at Town Hall Gardens to greet new town manager James Feeney. Hello, I'm Jeff Barn. Thank you, as always, for joining us. You'll recall Feeney became town manager August the 1st after serving as the town's deputy manager for operations, a position James Feeney held since July of 2021. In recent years, among other responsibilities, Feeney managed pandemic response strategies in Arlington schools and buildings. He also oversaw building management, including repairs to the 110-year-old town hall building, namely that leaky roof and the damaged clock tower. More on that in just a second. In April of this year, the select board unanimously named Feeney as Arlington's next town manager at an annual salary of $225,000 with benefits. Feeney, of course, succeeding Sandy Puller, who retired 2 months ago.
Truly honored to be Arlington's town manager. Certainly has been a long journey to get here, but yet it still feels new and different every single day. But I'm both thrilled and excited.
You know, for 2 years, we've gone through three town managers now. You had Adam, who left, obviously, and then you had Sandy, who made it very clear, I'm only going to be here for a year, and then I'm going to retire. Yep. So there seems to be the decision to bring you on seems to have in mind in the future more stability at the top position.
Yeah, I hope that's the case. Again, you know, I've worked here since 2009, and I could hopefully see myself finishing my career here. So here's to hopefully a long tenure.
It's very hard to predict, but for the next 6 months, what's your priority at this point being town manager?
I think, you know, there's never just one priority, of course. You know, a few priorities are going to be trying to keep our, you know, major building projects on track, including DPW and, you know, closely monitoring the high school building project. Obviously, we have, you know, committees overseeing both, you know, and next challenges. We've made some progress in you know, filling some key positions, including backfilling my job, but, you know, making sure we hire all the personnel we need to get as close to full strength as possible. And then finally, I think it's going to be, you know, sort of looking forward to, you know, an override that's a vote that's scheduled for November. And, you know, depending on the outcome of that, is planning for what the financial impacts may or may not be.
As he has done in the past, Feeney's set to be at Town Day before the sun arises, marking the street so that everybody knows where their booths are going to be. That is dedication. It'll be your chance to say hello and make yourselves known to our new town manager. Okay, now on to the renovation of Town Hall. We told you about the massive leak at Town Hall earlier this year as town leaders seek to restore the building, including that iconic clock tower. The facilities department back in January applied tarps to the exterior, you may recall, of this tower to limit further water damage. Now, this is what it looked like in the Lions hearing room 9 months ago, directly below the tower. And this is what it looks like this week. We talked to Jim Feeney, who you may recall took this project on as deputy town manager, which made us ask, now that Mr. Feeney is our new town manager, who's taking this massive project over?
So as of right now, that project still falls within my hands. Frankly, it might be tough for someone to get it out of my hands because that building has been home for so long, and I just love the building. I love learning about its history, and I love trying to be a good steward for it now and with an eye towards the future. So as of right now, we do have a design team on board that's drawing up the plans and specifications that will help us properly document its history, maintain the pieces that we need to maintain, come up with a plan for its removal, identify which pieces we need to store, which pieces we need to replicate, but how we're going to make the building watertight once that comes down so that we can sort of prevent further damage in the Lion's Hearing Room and then move forward with repairs in that space and get it back online. It's a very valuable space, but you know, we've had to take it offline due to the water damage. So
we thought it would be a seamless transition to someone else. You're not letting this baby go.
Not this one.
The Lion's Hearing Room is off limits until further notice. And recommendations are already in the works to remove the clock tower completely before renovations begin. One idea is to issue a bond to cover the millions it's going to take to restore Town Hall and make sure the building is watertight. The town's still actively working toward a restoration plan and also funding. As of October the 2nd, Julie Wayman will be Arlington's new town treasurer collector. Among other things, Wayman will oversee investments, borrowing money, and tax collecting. Prior to her new job title, Wayman served in the town manager's office since 2019 in many capacities, such as management analyst and budget director. Arlington's deputy town manager, finance director, Alex McGee, says Wayman is an excellent choice for this new position, adding that she's already a very valued member of the town's finance team, having delivered exceptional results with a budget and her constant collaboration with various town departments over the years. Again, Ms. Wayman begins her new role on the 2nd of October. Arlington's former Health and Human Services Director, meantime, will have to change her business card. She has a new job title. Christine Bongiorno is now Arlington's new Deputy Town Manager of Operations. She began her new job on Monday, September the 11th, and that's when we caught up with her and asked her about her brand new role serving the town of Arlington.
So I'm going from managing a department, a pretty significant department in town, the Department of Health and Human Services, with a number of divisions, to now supporting all of the department heads through the town manager's office. Working with the management team, I'll be looking at making sure we do an evaluation of really roles and responsibilities and making sure that we're covering all of the duties that need to be covered and just really assessing and trying to understand the needs of the department heads as well as the town in general.
How does it feel to be a part of a town? You've done this for years now. You're just assuming a new position. However, it's in the same town dealing with a lot of the same people. It's got to be really exciting for you.
Absolutely. I mean, living and working in the same town has been really rewarding for me. I think that knowing that I was ready for a change, being able to make that change be here in Arlington was very rewarding, I have to say.
As the Director of Health and Human Services for the town of Arlington, Ms. Bongiorno carried out several responsibilities, as you could imagine, not the least of which was guiding Arlington residents through the global COVID-19 pandemic. There are many exciting announcements regarding the town's library system right over there, namely, reimagining its future. Library Director Anna Litten is set to be at Town Day to answer any questions people may have about Arlington's libraries. Right now on the front burner is bringing the Edith M. Fox Library at 175 Mass Ave up to speed.
The thing that we're working on now that we're very excited about is re-envisioning the Fox Branch Library. So we just had an RFP process out. We are soliciting consultants to help us do some space design work at the Fox Branch Library at 175 Mass Ave. It's a really important community space that has been underappreciated for a while, really. And it's really time to think about what the community needs in that space and how we can set up a space that best meets our community needs and the services the library is looking forward to providing to meet those needs.
Which is great, and it's a crucial part of the library system right here in Arlington. Now, as usual, I guess you'll be here for Town Day. What's your display going to be like?
Oh yeah, we're really excited. We're using our booth to solicit some community feedback, to really not just to have an opportunity to get information out, but to get some information in as well, to hear from our residents. The thing that we're really excited about at Town Day, though, is that Robbins Library will be open. Robbins Library Library has not been open to the public for many years on Town Day, and we're using this as an opportunity to showcase some interesting pieces from the library. So we are having a display of some materials from our local history room. We're going to be offering tours of the library, and I think it's going to be a great time for residents to come see us in a little bit of a different way.
To learn more about what's going on at Arlington's libraries, just go to their website, robinslibrary.org. Again, the website is robinslibrary.org. State lawmakers are considering legislation that some say would make it the first state in the nation to levy fees on streaming companies like Netflix and Hulu to help fund community media outlets like ACMi TV. The measure proposes a 5% fee on digital streaming providers based on a company's gross annual revenue in this state. Part of the fee would be distributed to municipalities to support their community media centers. The proposed measure aims to bolster revenue, which is being lost as more and more viewers are using streaming services while cutting the cord on their cable service. The cables make up a very sizable portion of community media budgets.
I mean, you guys, broadcast the school committee meetings, select board meetings, other meetings, events, meetings. You know, you bring the town of Arlington to town hall, or, you know, conversely, the town hall to the people of Arlington when they're busy taking care of their families and can't get involved necessarily. You bring them the information. So it's really concerning that, you know, access to important public information, public media, seems to be going away. So it is really incumbent upon all of us in government across the state to make sure that doesn't happen, to make sure that local access television like ACMi and things across the state can continue to deliver incredible service. So there is a piece of legislation up at the State House that I am supporting that would make this commitment and put it in concrete to make sure it doesn't go away and take sure that the investment in local media and ACMi continues. So we need to do everything we can to make sure the legislation passes, and I look forward to continuing to support it just so you and ACMi can continue doing the great work bringing such important information to the people of Arlington.
Advocates for the bill say cable subscriptions have decreased by more than 30% in the state from their apex just a decade ago. And COVID, of course, did nothing to help that concern. While that measure is under consideration, you can help your public access station so that the public, government, and educational programs like this newscast continue airing stories that affect all of us here in Arlington. Not Boston, not Cambridge, Salem, or Scituate. Arlington. Just go to acmi.tv/donate. Again, that's acmi.tv/donate. And of course, we certainly appreciate your continued viewership and support. ACMi is working with the Cyrus Dallin Art Museum to piece together a major project which focuses on one of Arlington's favorite sons, the world-renowned artist Cyrus Edwin Dallin. Now, in recent weeks, we have been promoting and producing an oral histories program. Area residents reading firsthand accounts of people who came in contact with this master artist and have a fascinating story to tell. A little different this week. Here's a sample of our project about a young girl, Barbara Nelson, who knew Cyrus Dallin as a kind man, not as a superstar in the artistic world. And it is a memory that she certainly has for keeps.
I was born in Arlington, November 30th, 1929. I went to the Pierce School, Junior High West and Arlington High School. It wasn't rural, but it was quiet. You stayed in town for the most part. We had public transportation, so you could travel a lot, but we walked a lot. We would walk up to the reservoir and swim. And we walked all over town. It was just something you did then, something kids don't do now. And we played in the neighborhood a lot. You did a lot of things with the children in your neighborhood, everybody, boys and girls. Whether you skated, played baseball, and we could sled until 5 o'clock at night. This was before World War II, and a lot of people were still in the Depression. And then when World War II came along, nobody really drove a car often. But I lived at the base of overlooking Ronald Road, and that was quite a steep hill. I was about 10, so I'd say, I think around 10, about 1939. I used to take my younger brother and we'd walk up to his studio, which is in a barn.
Right.
And if he was working, we were allowed to go in. He would stop work and he would give us clay to mold in our hands. And he was working on a very large piece. It was covered with damp canvas, and he would take the canvas off and let us look at it. And Mrs. Dallin would come in, she'd bring cookies and lemonade. And I think he wore a smock sometimes, and was it a beret?
Yes.
Yes. And he took a lot of time and spent it with the children, which was, it was very exciting for us. This was a celebrity. A few years ago, we went on a Johnny Appleseed tour out toward the middle part of the state. And one of the stops was a small village where there were a group of artisans. And we went in the sculptor's studio, and I spoke with a sculptor. I'd seen he did mainly Indians. The eyes on the Indians were, they were distinct, not like some of the other sculptors. You could see each fold in the eyelid. I told him they looked like the eyes on Cyrus Dallin's Indians. They were sort of distinctive. And he said, I studied under Cyrus Dallin. We were quite surprised because so many people haven't heard of him.
Did Cyrus any time, talk with you? Or?
Yes, he would stop and talk with us. And he had some sort of a dedication, something that was in next to the town hall, probably sometime early 40s. I was still young. But I remember he told us about it, and my brother and I went. There was a good crowd there.
Do you remember any pieces in particular that you saw, either in the studio or, in the neighborhood?
Well, the Indian monotomy, that was one. That was the most impressive. Then we stopped going. I don't know if we grew up, or of course, by then you were teens,
right?
And you did other things. But it was a nice town to grow up in. We were very fortunate.
Few museums in the world are located in the town where the artist actually lived and worked, and we are among the select few. To get much more information on this upcoming series or all the events occurring at the Cyrus Dallin Art Museum this summer and early fall, just go to the museum's website, dallin.org. Again, that is dallin.org. It has been a banner year for Arlington's Historical Society. They've been having fun all summer long. For the second straight year, the ice-cold beer was flowing at the very well-attended beer gardens on the front lawn of the historic Jason Russell House. Patsy Kramer from Arlington's Historical Society tells me that because of the beer gardens this summer and last, it has helped many people learn about the Battle of Menotomy, especially with the bloodiest fighting that took place on the grounds of 7 Jason Street on April the 19th, 1775.
The beer garden has just been fantastically successful. People love coming. It's a beautiful setting. You know, it's a big green lawn. It has a beautiful stone wall as a perimeter, and people love to come, sit in the shade, sit on the wall, bring their chairs, bring their dogs, bring their kids, and have a couple of beers and socialize. And from our standpoint, it's really put us on the map, in a sense, in Arlington, because many people will say, I always knew this yellow house was sitting here, but I didn't know what it was about. And now that they've been coming to the beer garden, they come up and they find out a little more about what this house is all about, which, of course, the claim to fame is that the house itself was in the Revolutionary War, at the beginning of the war, when the British retreated from Concord, and there was a big battle here in Arlington where 13 soldiers were killed. The Historical Society has had a great couple of years with the visibility that the beer garden has provided. And we've also been very successful at getting a lot of grant money, some of it from the CPA here in Arlington. And we've really been able to shore up this historical house. We've done chimney work, we've done gutter work, we've got sill work. So with the help of all of this funding, we really put the historical house in good stead. The other thing we've done, there's a building attached to the house itself that was meant to be like a barn, and that's a museum for the Historical Society. And we got earmark money from the legislature during COVID, and we completely renovated the museum so that now it can function both as a museum and as an event site. And so people can think about having a small party here. Use the lawn and use the inside. So we've had a rehearsal dinner, we've had a small wedding, we've had memorial service, an 80th birthday party. So if you're thinking about a fun event that's kind of small in scale, think about us.
The Jason Russell House is open for tours Saturdays and Sundays, 1 to 4 in the afternoon. And the Smith Museum, right next door, is open at the very same time. For more information, just go to the Society website, arlingtonhistorical.org. Again, that is arlingtonhistorical.org. Remember the 60s? Don't give me that. Of course you remember the 60s. One of the biggest touring acts of the 60s is coming to the Regent Theatre Friday, October the 6th, the Cowsills. The band behind such mega hits as The Rain, The Park, and Other Things, Hair, and Indian Lake will be in concert at the Regent Theatre. The Cowsills, of course, inspired the hit television series The Partridge Family with Shirley Jones. This week, I got to talk to the Cowsills before their Arlington engagement. Then I do.
Yeah, October 6th at the Regent Theater in the historic Regent Theater in Arlington, Massachusetts. This is our backyard. We grew up in Rhode Island, you know, and we're coming to us. We're coming home, and we want all our homies to get out there and come out with us that night. Absolutely.
There's a lot of people out there who don't know that you were the template for the Partridge Family. Tell us about that. And you're good friends with Shirley Jones.
The Partridge Family, we were actors and actresses, and the Cowsills were really the musicians and really the music, you know, and she kind of like made that public at that moment. That was kind of a cool thing to hear from her, you know, that they did think about us. And, you know, she was definitely into the music part of that, but she is a dear person. And yeah, we've kind of taken her on as our like, you know, surrogate mom.
This is Susan Cowsill from the Cowsills, and we want y'all to come out to the Regent Theater October 6th, 7 o'clock, and spend an entire evening hanging out with the Cowsills. That'd be me, Susan, Paul, and Bob. So come on out. It's going to be a blast.
Flowers in her hair. Flowers everywhere.
Prior to the concert, there will be a conversation with the Cowsills live on stage with music journalist Jim Sullivan. For more info on this event and all the shows coming to the Regent this fall, just go to their website, regenttheatre.com. Again, that's Regent Theatre with an R-E.com. The rain, the park, and other things is now my earworm for the rest of the week, and a pleasant earworm at that. Incidentally, ACMI has a booth set up at ACMi and Mass Ave for Town Day. Stop by and say hi. If you can't make it for Town Day, we'll cover it live on our public channel from start to finish. And of course, you'll be able to see our Town Day coverage live on our website, as always, acmi.tv. We're just jam-packed with information this week. There's just too much in a half hour. Whew. That'll do it for this week's edition of ACMI News. I'm Jeff Barn. Thank you, as always, for joining us. We will see you back here next week. Take care.
You can always check out our latest segments and newscasts on the web at acmi.tv/news. And don't forget to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter and Instagram at ACMI News. Make sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel as well. You'll find us at youtube.com/ACMI News. If you have any news tips for us or wish to become a citizen journalist, we'd love to hear from you. Email us at news@acmi.tv or stop by ACMI Studio A at 85 Park Avenue.